when he's walking off.
Yeah. Just very quickly, apologies for those joining on YouTube. I forgot to. You need to start reminding me about that. Apologies to the people on YouTube. But anyway, yeah.
We just lost 2,000 on YouTube.
Yeah, Dylan Knapper.
If you read his lips when he's walking off, he says, bunch of pussies.
Is that what he said?
Actually, his lips. God. To be honest, if he'd have said that to me, I'd have tended to agree with him. But,
I think, look, let's put this into perspective. For those who don't watch the NRL, in the NRL last year, they did something very, very similar. And it was carnage. And there was cries from the fans, from the pundits, from the coaches. I mean, it's happened over here already. I saw Willie Poaching's interview. Obviously, it was the Jake Connor one in his. But I think Dylan Knapper's banged to rights. I don't think anybody can argue with that one. James Bentley, was it yellow? Was it red? Widdop's on his way down. Yes, there was a Clemson, but it was a bad end. He copped him. But I mean, if it was a yellow, it's a yellow.
What I did like about that, and again, going back to Channel 4 coverage, was you heard the referee explain why it was a red.
Yeah.
And you also heard him explain later on why Oliver Holmes's wasn't a red. And I thought, okay, whether you agree with him or not, he's explained it. You can hear him. You could hear the video ref as well. On Channel 4, and I thought that was really good, listening to the video ref going through the processes. The Jake Connor one,
I didn't see it, mate.
I saw it. You see the guy go down, and somebody I think wrote on social media, we're going to get players feigning head high tackles to get players sent off.
Yeah, well, but this is the thing, and this is why what we do is so important. And actually, I pray to God at some point Channel 4 do some sort of fanzine show, because NRL 360 in Australia, they went massive on the players that were doing that. They really put the boot in, so it wasn't in the spirit of the game. Last season you're bouncing up wanting to go toe to toe, and this season you're rolling round, and literally within two or three rounds it stopped. And I think that's what we've got to do. We've got to say, look, because I think Danny Outon went over and we'll see it in a minute when we look at the Hull game. But Danny Outon actually goes over to the player, and I think at one point you could hear him actually say, get up, because that's just not, it's just not in the spirit of the game.
Well, we called it out last year with a few football less dives from players that were winning penalties, and that kind of got cleared up. I'm not saying we're responsible by any means of the imagination, but rugby league fans were angry that rugby league players were acting like footballers and diving to get penalties. It's week one. Let's hope it calms down. I think we've had 7 players banned.
Yeah, it's quite a few. It is quite a few that have gone to the disciplinary committee. I mean, I posted.
Jake Connor shouldn't have even been playing. He had a broken hand.
Yeah, that came from nowhere. Yeah. That came from out, because, like I say, when we were doing this last week, Jake Connor wasn't playing, was he? I mean, that was the consensus of opinion, that Jake Connor was out, and then all of a sudden he's in, and you're like, oh God, where's that come from? And then, of course, he's taking an early shower. But, I mean, it's interesting, though, isn't it? Because, I mean, Dylan Knapper, we were texting each other throughout the game, and I think you said he's not going to last long here, and I said, I agreed with you, and lo and behold, he got sent off. We've spoke about Jake Connor before in terms of, I felt for him. It's not petulant. I felt for him. Of the three that got sent down, I felt the most for Jake Connor. Gil Dudson as well. I mean, he's got a 3-game ban for supposedly punching. Now, I don't call that a punch at the start of that game. Well, that's not a punch. That was a push.
What sparks it? There's a rumour going around that he was gouged, and you see his eye. And,
Well, he got a cut, didn't he? Obviously, the collision was a big collision. There was a big, wasn't it? Big collision, I get that. But, I mean, when you looked at the footage, it was a push. He didn't even have a clenched fist. So that, for me, is an interesting one. Albert Vete of Hull KR, 2 matches for a grade C. Bentley, I can't believe that, it's a brave decision. Alex Sharp here, what about the punch in the first 17 seconds of the match? Alex, I think Greg just said that. Yeah, I just didn't see that one for Gil Dudson, I have to say.
I think Gil Dudson was unlucky. You can see by his reaction. Yeah. To get a ban. In the good old days, you got a yellow card, and that was, I remember sending off sufficient.
Yeah. Yeah,
that
I mean,
seems to happen these days.
Right, I agree, mate. I agree. I think James Bentley's brave to contest. I really do. Yeah. But you know, he, I mean, because again, James Bentley's got history as well, so that probably goes against him a little bit. That'd be interested.
And yeah, David, I don't think he was ever sent off when he played for Saints, fully enough.
But does he know? Well, that's knowledge. That is knowledge. That is a fact, and knowledge is the bomb. David, who joined us last week, he's watching old Dave. James, so yeah, Ben Curry, no, nothing for him. Brad Dwyer's got a game. I was quite surprised about that. Ollie Holmes is contesting his. Reece Lynn of Wakefield Trinity has got a 3-match ban. Jake Connor, one. Andre Savelio has got 2, used to the knees, interesting. And that's about that. So, yeah, I mean, some big disciplinary things taking place there.
It's tough to take. If you've had a player who's been simbed and then they've been banned for a game, what's the point in simbing them?
It's a good point. It's a good point.
The referee, to me, the disciplining panel is there is if the referee has missed something. They should do like that. I think they do it in Australia. There's an auto for a red card, there's an automatic one game ban. You get points per card, isn't it? And then when you reach a certain number of points, you get a ban.
Right.
Let's bring that in here because the disciplining panel, it seems to be whichever way the wind's blowing, they'll make a decision.
Well, again, it's consistency both on the field but also in the disciplinary committee.
Exactly. I mean, I don't think there was anything Ben Curry's challenge. I think it was a good, solid hit. It's a sort of hit that
I enjoyed that
5 years ago.
Yeah, but if you look at the players, I mean, Fusitua and Curry were giving each other verbals, they were smiling at each other. It was a good contest. It's a good contest. That's what you want. You want, you know, people in the prime, you know, testing each other. I mean, that's what it's all about at that level.
And the issue there was, if he's going to miss the week with a head injury because of that, why didn't they get him off straight away? They let him play off.
Well, I was surprised at that.
He wasn't lad. So the issue there is with the Leeds staff allowing him to stay on the pitch, not Ben Curry's hit, to me.
No, I agree. Yeah, I was surprised to see him stay on for the length of time that he did. So anyway, we're talking about these games. Let's get into them. So in the spirit of 2022, a little bit different this year in terms of what we're doing. So let's get on with it. Here we go. Coming up. There you go. So the first game, of course, was St. Helens against Catalans, 28-10. You know, just giving a shout out here to the Betfred Super League YouTube channel. Every single game, within hours of the final whistle going, they do tend to post highlights all over Facebook, all over the YouTube channel. Make sure that you watch them. But what we're going to do, we're going to have a little watch as we're talking through it. Tell you what, I need to... 1 second, just need to do that because otherwise I won't be able to hear you. So this obviously is this is the first incident. I mean, that for me is a big hit. It's a fair hit. I've got no issue with that.
I don't know what sparks it, Dave. I've watched it a few times back and...
But that's not a punch for me. I'm sorry, that's not a punch. I'm not buying for 1 minute that is a punch.
Plus, the referee has dealt with it.
Yeah,
it's yellow carded him. If it's going to be the case where players are double punished, then get rid of yellow cards.
I mean, look at that. It's an open hand. It's an open hand. Sorry, but I'm not seeing that as a punch.
No.
For the disciplinary committee to have actually given him 3 matches for that, I think Simbin on the night, I actually said that I thought that was harsh for the pure reason that these were the two top teams of 2021. They're going into the first game of the season, first minute. You know, it's gonna be. You know, they're all psyched up, they're ready to go. Yes, there's been a little bit of argy-bargy. The ref's got to say, look, lads, we're 1 minute in, let's calm down. Let's just calm this down, let's go again. So I even thought the yellow was harsh. The fact that he's now got this ban, that, of course, was the disallowed try for Hadjihar there going in. Yeah. But, yeah, very, very surprised that they got the ban. And I do think they need to, you know, we say this every year, they need to speed up these referees' decisions.
Yeah, well, that was the thing on Channel 4. I think the decisions were made a lot more quickly than on Sky.
Yeah, hello, Paul. Paul Stevenson has just joined us. Vicky Johnson, hello to you.
Didn't they used to have a clock? They used to put a clock on it, didn't they?
Yes.
And then they took it off because it was taking far too long.
Good try there for Adyahar. We said on the night, you know, Yahar and Davis last year, both of them were absolutely clinical for Catalan. A couple of tries like this, that was certainly not the best of the ones like that this week, but quite a few little chip over the top.
Good to see a variety of tries from close in to long range to kicks over the top.
Yeah. You know, it's a great step.
Had absolutely everything.
That was a great step for Mataltia there. Yeah. Great step. I mean, that is a cracking little step. And, you know, if you're going to give Makinson that much room, he's going to find the line in it.
Of course he is. Of course.
Absolutely
he is.
Superb from Tommy Makinson. This was, I mean, you know, Conrad Hurrell. What a game Conrad Hurrell had. I mean, this is just strength. It's determination. Credit Robe being there. Just Conrad Hurrell could be the steal of the season.
Well, you know, Leeds fans weren't that disappointed to see him go, so I believe. And James Roby just doing what James Roby does. I mean, he's 126 now, James Roby. He's still, you know, supporting like he was an 18-year-old. So, yeah, it's...
This was lovely. This is an absolute thing of beauty. And again, Conrad Hurrell had a big part to play in that one as well, but that was a thing of beauty. We spoke about Lewis Dodd last week, and, you know, there's no question the ability this boy's got.
No, I thought he stood up well. You know, he was replacement hooker last year, I believe. Right. So to go from hooker to number seven...
And let's be fair...
He stood up well.
He was coming up against Mitchell Pearce, mate. There's the napper sending off. Got no issue with that. You know, we came up against Mitchell Pearce, and it's got to be said, mate, Lewis Dodd was far more impressive on the night than
Mitchell Pearce. As I think I said last week, though, you know, this guy's come over from Australia. It'll be foreign conditions to him. Yeah. Weather won't suit him. There he goes. He says, you're a bunch of pussies.
Yeah. It was a bad in that. It's a bad in that. I've got no issue with that at all. That is a three-match ban. There's no place for that. That's a shoulder charge. They've been banned for years. It was a poor technique. And to be fair, he was revving up about 10 minutes before that one.
Well, I texted you and said Napper will be suspended more than he plays this season.
Yeah. No,
but the thing that made me laugh in this game was Napper went in for challenge just before that. And Lou McCarthy Scarsbrook came running in all bluster, and Napper stood up and McCarthy Scarsbrook went in behind Dodds.
Really pleased to see Joey Lussich go over for one. You know, good try from him there. And then, of course, the gift from Sam Tompkins to Hurrell. And, you know, Hurrell, fair play to him. You know, deserved that try on the night. You know, man of the match was given to Lewis Dodd. But I think Conrad Hurrell, I think if he'd have been given man of the match, I don't think anybody would have had anything harsh to say on that.
I think he had probably... Apart from one or two games for Leeds, his best game in Super League.
No, I agree.
What I've seen of him, anyway, you know, Leeds fans may disagree, but yeah. I thought that he looked a lot fitter this time around than he did last season.
Completely agree, mate. I thought St. Helens. I mean, again, let's not write the Super League off before we even get started. Hang on a minute. David said it's four games. My apologies, Dave. Four games and a £500 fine for Napper. First time listening, enjoying it. If this is a weekly thing, it is Alex Sharp. Welcome, Alex. Make sure that you subscribe. Make sure that you put on the Facebook. Get on the fans forum if you're not on there. Great to have you along, young man. Great to have you along. You know, he's going to be 65 being called the young man, isn't he? He's going to be delighted. No, his picture. He's younger than that, bless him.
Well, if he's not, we've just lost him.
We've just lost him, yeah. But yeah, no, you know, same telling to me. Martin Sadler in the League Express, though, Gary Schofield, they're all coming out saying four times. And there's a lot of rugby league to play between now and the end of the season. I think... It's too early, albeit it has to be said. St. Helens, if you're going to win the Super League, you're going to have to knock them out, whether it be in the playoffs or whether it be in the final, because there's no doubt about it.
I think it takes something spectacular. I mean, that game was, the first 20 minutes was brutal.
Yeah. And
I was watching it from behind the settee. It was that Friday.
Oh, I've done it again. I'll tell you what's interesting, mate. I'll tell you what's really interesting is the attendances. Good effort on the attendances. You know, Cass getting 10,500. We'll see that later. 13,178 people to watch the 28-10 at St. Helens. Fantastic. Absolutely fantastic. Yeah, yeah. So,
and you know what? I really hope, because there's been a question about whole season ticket sales. I really hope that stadium on Saturday is as full as it can possibly be.
Yeah, let's hope so. And I hope the cast fans. And I hope that the cast bands come out again in droves when they get back to the jungle, because, you know, yes, we need a vibrant TV audience, of course we do, but we also want to see it on the terraces, because, again, going back to the Channel 4 game, the atmosphere that was coming through on the TV you know, was fantastic. Yeah. And that's what we need. There's nothing worse than seeing the Sky cameras and empty stands. Ethan Price, Dominic Wilkinson, Alex Holden, new names all the time coming in. Good to see you guys. Great to have you. But it was right. So we'll move on. We'll move on to the next game, which was the Friday night game, which saw the Hull KR take on the Wigan Warriors. I've said that I expect big things from Wigan this season. And I think, you know, in the first game, they show more invention than they did the whole of last.
God forgive me, but I was impressed with Wigan.
Yeah, I agree.
Albeit they were helped with some mistakes.
Well, two from Warden.
And KR made a lot of mistakes.
Yeah, you take those two errors out from Wood, it's a lot tighter game. But, you know, that they're the breaks, aren't they, at the end of the day? Jake Bibby, you know, there he goes. He's got, you know, got plenty of tries.
I mean, what last he did last Wigan. Season, starting like a house on fire.
Indeed. Do you know what I like, Mikey Lewis? I really, really do. He scored that try, of course, in Halliwell Jones against Warrington and the players. And this, again, just a little stroke of genius from that. Look at this. Great. Yes. Look at that burst of pace through the gap. That's a beautiful try. It really is.
That was in my top three tries of the week, I have
was
to
say.
Yeah, that was, well, it was Blake Austin-esque, that step.
Well, my try of the week we've just seen, I went for Lewis Dodds. And actually, the fans forum went for the one we just seen a moment ago, which was Jay Field. Over 40 votes. That's right, ladies and gentlemen. Every week we're going to put the top five tries on, put your votes in. And also, you'll have seen it today on the fans forum. We've been asking you for your predictions all day for round two. Oh, sorry, this is the Jay Field try, sorry.
This is
beautiful
try.
Beautiful. You know, seeing the predictions on the fans forum today, get your predictions in. We took a straw poll of the fans forum predictions, and they're the ones that are going up against me and Greg's, and we'll share those with you a little bit later. But yeah, Jay Field,
that's in my top three as well.
Yeah, quality try. Cade Cust, to be fair, had a decent game for Wigan, I have to say.
I did say pre-season that they think a lot of Cade Cust at Wigan. You know, they're a threat, Wigan, this season, I think.
I agree.
If Jayfield stays fit, if they can get Bevan back, Bevan French back.
Yeah, this was a good try as well, to be fair. I mean, Liam Marshall, I mean, you know, it was good this week because there was invention, there was length of the field tries. We'll see, you know, I think we'll see when we see the Wakefield game, what the try, but a brilliant break from Tom Johnson.
We've seen this week every type of try scored, from a barge over, from a run from your own half.
Yeah.
An interception, a kick over, a couple of kicks over the top. We've probably seen almost every which way a try can be scored this weekend.
Yeah.
Which is brilliant. Absolutely fantastic. I've not enjoyed an opening weekend like this for a long, long time.
No, and again, I agree.
Another mistake by the lad.
Yeah, Dave from last week's come in, he was right. I mean, Dave's pointing there to the Lee Breers effect. You know, he did have a feel of a Lee Breers in the Wigan performance in terms of, you know, what Wigan were doing. I think I completely agree with that. I can't argue with that assessment. Sam Wood, you know, I'm pleasing to see, well, not surprised, you know, Tony Smith came straight out and, you know, put his back into Sam Wood in terms of, you know, the career he believes the kid's going to have. And, you know, you'd expect nothing less from Tony Smith on that, would you?
No, you wouldn't. And the thing with having a touch of Lee Breers about it, you've got to have the players to execute that. And it looks like Wigan could very well have that this season.
Yeah, no, I agree. Bad news for Ian Fawnley. Ian Fawnley going to be out for 2 months for Wigan. It's been announced today. So that's a shame. I mean, Ian Fawnley, you know, coming back from Lee, he'll be disappointed to be missing. They've got plenty of cover, obviously, in that position. But I feel for Ian Fawnley.
Yeah, but Peace Park played well, quite well at centre when he played against us in the pre-season friendly. So, he's a big lad to be run at you in the centres.
Yeah, and he's only going to get better. I've got a lot of time for Kai Pierce Ball, and there's Liam Marshall second to complete the scoring.
But of course, you can always play Liam Farrell in the centres as well if you want to.
Yeah, absolutely.
He's no slouch.
No, they've got, I mean, I feel like, again, when we looked at the squads before the season starts, you know, Wigan have got a lot of cover in a lot of positions. This was the final try of the game. Obviously, that was Wigan's final one there a moment ago, but a little fortuitous. But Matt Parcell, another player who had a fantastic 2021, he'll be wanting to back that up. Lachlan Coote, he'll be a bit disappointed, I think, with his opening game for KR, won't he?
He will, but as I've said, Lachlan Coote has got a tendency to drifting and out of games. I mean, you kind of, I think you had a little dig at me last season about this, but he does have a tendency to drift. He's got a mistake in him at the wrong time for whichever team he's playing for. But yeah. I mean, he's a good player. He's a grand final winner, for God's sake. But
he is, mate. He is. But it's like you were saying, he's not got the same 12 players in front of him at OKR. Exactly. And, you know, he's coming on the big books. Exactly. He's coming on the big books in terms of the salary cap, and there's going to be a lot of expectation. Hull KR, obviously, we'll get into round two a little bit later. But to be fair, that could have gone either way.
Both those games, I was a last gasp try away from getting 5 points in my predictions.
Yeah. Now, but again, though, I mean, I think the Catalan game, we'll come to that in a minute. You've done well, all right. We get, Catalans will be disappointed with themselves. Hull KR would have probably wanted it to be a bit tighter, but it's early days. Then, right, we're now going to head off to the Mendenhall's jungle. Man of the match in that game was Jay Field, wasn't it?
So we go now
to the Castleford game. Obviously, this one. Was against the Salford Red Devils. My team of the week, actually, the Salford Red Devils. I did not see this coming at all. I know Dave, I was surprised when Dave predicted how high he felt that Salford was going to finish this year. I think I had Salford finishing 10th.
Ninth.
And you had them ninth. Genuinely didn't see this one coming, I have to say. The Mark Snead effect is what I would say to this one. And Cass, of course, starting the game well.
Well, yeah. I mean, you know, you think then when Castleford go in early doors, you're thinking, well, this is the home win.
Yeah.
But are we putting too much precedence on how Salford have played in the last few seasons? They scored some good tries, Salford.
They did. I mean, Brodie Croft. He looks a player already. I think he'll do well. They've obviously beefed up the pack. You know, the King had a great game in this one. Great Ken Seo there, top try scorer last year. Going in for four. Obviously, we know about Sitter. They've got the players. Duello Fertz, another one who had a good 2021 going in there for his first.
And didn't do too bad in the stats this week as well, Duello Fertz, to be fair to him.
No, he didn't, mate. There was the King. The King going over. Running.
This is a great try.
Yeah. Yeah. Apologies. Predictive. A great run from Burgess. That predictive test put him in as Dion and not Dean, not Dion. But anyway, there you go. But yeah, great try. And to be fair, the finish was quite straightforward. Joe Burgess deserves a lot of credit there.
Yeah. You don't see many tries scored from a restart these days, but that was a superb try and almost in my top three.
Right. Okay.
Almost. Not quite.
But there's Olfert's going in. Good win. Great win for Salford. Didn't see it coming, genuinely. Mark Snead, brilliant.
Seven goals, 14 points. The difference.
Yeah. And an assist. You know, so not only was he kicking, but the assist there for the cross try as well. So yeah, Mark Snead, and you know, fair play to him. You know, everybody was surprised when he moved across to Salford in the close season. But what a start from him. Salford.
And a great start from Salford. I mean, that's probably the best start they've had in a long time.
And to lose this week. So actually, you know, if you're a Salford fan, especially based on the performance of Toulouse, which we'll see in a bit, I think, you know, Salford fans will be probably quite happy with that one, to be fair.
I think they would be expecting to win that. And that must be, no offence to you Salford fans, but apart from when he played Warrington, that must be a nice feeling to go into a game expecting to win.
Absolutely.
No offence to you Salford fans, because you always beat Warrington.
Well, speaking of Warrington, that's where we're going next. What a game. Channel 4, absolute credit has got to go here to the Leeds Rhinos. Down to 12 early on. On comes Brad Dwyer. Fantastic performance from Dwyer. Leeming, you know, moving from the hooker role into the halves, had a storming game as well. Aiden Caesar marshalled the team well as well. I mean, you could have picked any of those three. In fact, you could have also thrown Reece Martin into the equation as well for the Leeds Rhinos. But let's take a look at it. This is how it panned out. And of course, you know, Warrington were under the cosh right from the beginning. From the moment the game kicked off, for the first half hour, the game was in the Warrington half, and it was they needed something to happen, Warrington. And when it did, it was a moment of pure genius I would have to say Conor Wrench. I mean, the pass from Wrench to Russell is probably the try.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you had Salford as your team of the week. I had Leeds as my team of the week.
Yeah.
You forget that not only did they have a player sent off and a player Simbin, but they also lost Richie Myra to injury and still could have won the game. And this is my try of the week.
Yeah. Well, I'm not surprised. I was waiting for that. But no, it's a great try. It's a great
try. The only reason why it's the try of the week is because of the first try on, the first Super League try scored on terrestrial TV.
Fair enough. Well,
Jay Fields was a great try. The try from Salford just was a great try. But that, again, a length of the field try, that was my try of the week.
Yeah, well, that was
the... Here we go, here's James Bentley.
Like I say, it's on his way down. It's a bad one. It is a bad one. There's no doubt about it.
He's caught him from behind as well.
Yeah, it is a bad one. Byron Wilson, Leeds did very well. You're quite right, they did indeed. He questioned the referee in this game. But no, I mean, the fans forum, they put the Widdop try as their third favourite this week. Jay Field was one, Lewis Dodd second. There's the Tavano try. And, you know, to be fair to Leeds, you know, I don't know what happened with Warrington in terms of when they went down to 12. Did they just turn off? I really don't know.
No, I think Leeds up the game. Didn't Tavano get sent off last year in their first game?
Yes, he did. Or it was either the first. Was it St. Helens, wasn't it? Is it St. Helens?
Well, there's a surprise. Somebody gets sent off at St. Helens in the first game of the season.
I'm pretty sure it was St. Helens that he got sent off last year. Yeah.
And was it Thompson the year before got sent off in the first game as well?
Yeah. I think you're right on that as well. Yeah. I tell you, somebody's been researching today.
It's all in there.
Yeah, Matt Pryor there going over. He had a good year last year. He'll have another good year this year.
He had a good game, Matt Pryor again.
Yeah, absolutely. Josh Charlie
running forwards for once.
Yeah, he'll be pleased, won't he? He'll be pleased to have scored two tries because of, you know, his try return for the last probably two seasons hasn't been very good for Warrington. Certainly not at the levels that he would want or the club would want. But you know, the fact that he was in the right place, right time, managed to get over two, he'll be pleased with that.
The thing that upsets me about that try is look how far behind play Matautia is, and he's
he was receiving treatment. That's what happened there.
This is a good try.
Hanley's, yeah, that's brilliant. Poor defender. I mean, we just praised Charlie for two tries, but he'll be disappointed with his starting position for that one. But Hanley, to his credit, it was a very, very good try.
A great try.
Yeah, it was. Proper try from Hanley.
Yeah. He enjoyed himself, didn't he?
He did. And then, of course, Warrington, you know, striking back and needed to. It was, like I say, nobody... The Leeds performance in the first half was impressive, but then to come out, you know, having had the rollicking at half-time and Leeds to go further ahead, that would have took Warrington by surprise. But again, there, good assist from Stephen Ratchford for Josh Charnley there.
Yeah. And I think Stephen Ratchford rightly was man of the match.
No, it had to be a Leeds player. I mean, I think, am I right in thinking on Channel 4, was it Conor Wrench they gave it to on Channel 4? Was it Ratchford? Oh, yeah, it was Ratchford. Yeah, it was Ratchford. No, I agree. Good step from Wrench. But look, I think anybody who knows Warrington knows that this kid's going to be a superstar, Wrench. He's got great feet, great speed. Really pleased for him there, you know, to set one up and to score one.
A couple of errors have got to him.
Oh, don't know what's happening there with you, Greg.
He made a couple of errors. I mean, that in the... Am I here?
No, you're coming back one, mate. No, you're coming back.
There we go.
Yeah, the Dalek was in. Good kick there from Ratchford. Oh.
Ian's connection table. A couple of errors and one at the end could have cost us when he tried to find Ashton when he had the breakthrough, which I had my heart in my mouth. But fair play to the kid. Fair play to him. You know, he did well.
He did very well indeed.
Toby. Toby King could be in this weekend, which might be a little fair on the lad, but
yeah, well, Toby King and Jack Hughes.
Hello,
can you hear us, Greg?
Yeah,
Toby King and Jack. Toby King and Jack Hughes. Looking at the press conference Dal Powell's put together, Jack Hughes unlikely, albeit has been named in the squad. Toby King has got more of a chance. That's the news coming out of Warrington. For that one, we'll get to this week in a moment. Now we're going to go and go back to France, Le Français, Toulouse, of course, coming into Super League. He's still there, Reg. Can you hear me, Greg? Yeah, you are. Yeah, your picture went there for a moment.
I'm still here, sir.
Good man. So now we've got Toulouse and Giants. Man of the match on this one, Danny Levy, Levi. Is it Levy or Levi?
Olahea. Oh, Levi. Sorry.
Levi. Yeah, Levi. Danny Levi.
Danny Levi. Yeah,
brilliant. Absolutely brilliant in this game. I think Huddersfield Giants fans will be very pleased with their first, with their new number nine. Was busy all game around dummy half. But, you know, it was Toulouse who got off to a dream start, wasn't it?
It was.
You know, and at this point...
Another interesting fact.
Go for it. I didn't catch that, Greg. What did you say? Oh, we've got gremlins now. I don't know if it's me or if it's you, but anyway, we'll carry on. Toulouse, obviously, going back, going further forward to 10. Good try here from them. Are you back with us, Reg?
Another interesting fact was Chris Hill didn't give away a single penalty.
He didn't, no, he didn't. We're having a bit of gremlins, I think, with your
I've connection. Never been away, Dave.
Have you not? Are you still there?
I think it's when you play the videos, the gremlins.
Oh, right, okay, fair enough. Happy days. Yeah. So, Toulouse, fair play to them. Great start for them. This was a good try, to be fair. But then back came Huddersfield, and once Luke Yates scored this try, you just got that feeling that that Huddersfield were gonna take it on from here.
You had to fear for them from this point on.
Why did they keep doing short dropouts? I mean, I was sick of hearing it from John Wilkin. And I think it's absolutely crystal clear, by the way, that John Wilkin and Brian Carney don't get on. Dearie, there's a proper.
They don't like each other.
It doesn't appear that way.
I think it's probably a tactic they brought over from the Championship. It probably worked quite well last year. But, you know, against a Super League side that are going to be a lot faster, a lot fitter.
Yeah,
it's probably not going to work as well. That's the tactic they have to kind of work the way around. What I was saying before, Dave, I don't think you heard me. Quite interesting that Chris Hill didn't concede one penalty all night.
No, he didn't. You're right. These two brothers, though, seniors, the two seniors, Innes and Lewis, having a good game. This next try in a minute, which I think is Lewis Senior's, I'll be honest with you, this one for me, was one of the tries of the round without any doubt at all. Absolute, because it's not just the fact that it's the initial kick through from Lewis Senior, but the fact then that he presents himself for the return ball. I thought this was a phenomenal try on the night.
It was very well worked. I mean, that's a lovely little kick.
Beautiful. That's a thing of beauty. That. Yeah. You know, no matter what your shirt colour is, if your team scores a try like that, you're punching the air, aren't you? That's a proper bit of rugby.
Well, if your team concedes a try like that, you applaud it.
Yeah, it's a thing of beauty, absolute thing of beauty. You know, fit to win any match, even though of course it went a lot worse for Toulouse from there. But fantastic try. And then second half,
that was the break, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think once they got to that point, you know, to 16-10 at half time, it was game over. From there, it was a capitulation, really, wasn't it? from a from Toulouse.
That's a big word, Dave.
Capitulation. Like that. Yeah, well, you know, we try and mix up the old vocabulary on this show, don't we? We're not like other rugby league podcasts that can't string a sentence together without a bit of bad language. You know, we're down with the kids. You know, if you've got a 5-year-old or a 7-year-old, they're safe on a Tuesday night watching me and Sir Gregory. No doubt about that at all. No doubt. No. Yeah, absolutely. But no, great performance. That was Wardle. Wardle needs a big season. You know, there's a lot of people saying that he might, you know, if a proper effort from Wardle this year puts him in World Cup contention.
He needs to fulfil his potential this year. There's a World Cup at the end of it.
Yeah,
and if he wants to be anywhere near that World Cup squad, he has to fulfil his potential. And he could very well get into that squad. Yeah. I think this was a must win for Huddersfield. That was a great try.
Absolutely, yeah. And McQueen, another player who played well last year and has got off to a flyer.
Yes, but this was a must win for Huddersfield.
Yeah,
they couldn't afford to lose this game.
No,
and it'll be interesting Salford at the weekend because Toulouse can't afford to lose that.
No, so, and equally, you know, Huddersfield go up against Hull KR, and that you know, we're early in the season, but you know, Hull KR need to win that. You know, but it's at Huddersfield, and you know, it's one of those Huddersfield win. It's a massive plus for them to go two from two.
It is.
If OKR lose that, Ashall Bolt there coming on, of course, from sub and getting his try to just seal the scoring for.
He needs an injury free season, Ashall Bolt. He needs to stay clear of injuries. A bit like Tom Johnston at Wakefield.
Yeah.
They need to stay clear of injuries because they're great players on the day.
Incredible.
And if they can get a good season again, you know, there could be a World Cup place for them.
Absolutely, mate. Absolutely. Can't disagree with that. But no, well done to Huddersfield. I mean, we were talking about it last week when we were doing the predictions. You know, this was a game we did to lose with the unknown quantity. It was absolutely essential that Huddersfield hit the ground running and got the win. They did exactly that. Of course, the final score went the way of Toulouse, which again, do you know what? I don't know about this lad's defending, but to be fair, he looked, you know, in attack, Armitage looked decent.
Yeah, you broke up there, Dave. So I didn't get
saying that, in attack, Armitage, I thought he looked decent in attack.
Yes, yeah. I mean, he's up against a tiring defence.
Yeah.
But, you know, he does look a handful of a player, I must admit. He does. I think he would do well in any other Super League team. He looks a handful.
Yeah, absolutely. And then, of course, the round came to a close on Sunday in the game where Luke Gale, you know, went of course to Hull. Big game for him. We have managed to find the footage for this one, which I'm pleased to say. I'm just going to get it set up ready for us. Managed to find the footage actually on Sky for this one.
I struggled to find the footage.
It's not been posted yet on the Super League Facebook page, but hey, there you go. That is life, as they say. So let's take a look at this game and also take a look at the Jake Connor incident. Here it comes. So, big win for Hull FC. They always start well, Hull FC, and then they fade as the season goes. Yeah, yeah. But this was a good step. This was a good step. Look at that. Oh, that's lovely. That is nice. Beautiful. Beautiful.
Support play.
Yeah, beautiful. Yeah, and again, it's like I say, Connor win that. I mean, you know, we've seen so many, as you say, we're so varied this first week. You know, we've seen lovely sidestepping. You know, we see pace, we've seen invention. This is good to see. Tom Johnson, Torrid 2021. There he is in full speed. Got to give credit there to cover defence here. Win again. Look at that. Connor win. That's
a great tackle.
Yeah, just set up a try and then save one at the other end. But of course, there was no stopping them going in. You know, the damage was done. And the try was scored, but Connor Wynn, he'll be delighted there. You know, score, set one up, save one.
Yeah, and good for Tom Johnson. He gets through a challenge like that and unscathed.
Yeah,
your heart's in your mouth every time Tom Johnson gets tackled.
Well, his tries are belter as well. I mean, you know, we know how good a player that's.
That's a great try.
He came on. I don't like that
celebrating before you've scored a try. Just get the ball over the line, son.
Well, you can always drop it, mate. That's happened a few times in the past.
Yeah, just don't celebrate till you get the ball on the ground, mate.
Yeah, Jake Connery setting up the final Hull FC score. McIntosh on his debut.
Pass from Connor.
Yeah,
looking at Connor giving it to the Wakefield players instead of celebrating the try.
Now I feel for Connor here. I think this is a slap around the chops. I'm sorry, but that's not that for me. Is you have a little word, you know, give him a yellow. Yeah, if you want to give him a yellow for reckless play, by all means do. But that's not a red. And like I say, when you actually listen to that footage, Danny Alton clearly says, "Get up, mate." We don't want that in the game where we've got play acting. I think there was a bit of that in that one.
Yeah, there was a, I don't know if it was last season or the season before, when Warrington played Wigan and Hill went in with a high tackle. The player was going down over the line. The hooker, what's his name for Wigan?
Powell, Sam Powell.
He's going down over the line and Hill catches him. And O'Loughlin actually runs up and says, "Stay down. He'll get a red," and he can hear it clearly on the pitch side microphone. "Stay down, he'll get a red." And what happens next? He gets a red.
Contentious. Yeah. That's going to get the Wigan fans going, isn't it? Lee Baggy Baxter, Jim Roberts, Keith Tracy McGuinness. What a great name. I presume that's Keith. I don't know, Keith Tracy McGuinness. Alex Sharp still with us. He's loving it. Loving it is Alex, which is good to see. So that was the week that was a phenomenal, phenomenal week. That was what we're going to do now, ladies and gentlemen. It's back. It is back. Just for those people who wasn't sure, was it going to be back? Was it not going to be back? Of course it's back. We're now going to go and do a little bit of Team of the Week. The Super League Raw Team of the Week for round number one is on its way. So me and Greg will just say cheerio for a moment or two. And we'll ask now who has made the Super League Raw Team of the Week for round number one. It's the Super League Raw Team of the Week for round number one. Here we go again. And at full back, it's Jay Field of the Wigan Warriors, keeping out Toy LaHoya this week. A great try, but his all-round game also contributing well to the Wigan win. Bevan French, he's not going to have it easy. He's dislodging this man on his return. And number two will be Tommy Makinson of St. Helens. How consistent has he been throughout his career? And another brace to start Super League 2022. Well done to Tommy. We hope his form continues for the Saints. And at number three, will be his compadre, Conrad Hubble, perhaps the best bit of business in the close season with a try and assist. And of course, he was pivotal in the lead up to the Lewis Dodd try as well. Well played to Conrad Hubble. And at number four, partnering him in the centres will be Jake Bibby of the Wigan Warriors. As with last year, he's got off to a great start to the season with two tries. And of course, as competition increases at Wigan for that spot, he will be looking to continue this form. And at number five is his teammate, Liam Marshall, who also scored two on the opening night of the season there against Hull KR. Liam Marshall will be pivotal on the edges this season for the Wigan Warriors. At number six, it was Mark Sneed of Salford Red Devils. Seven perfect kicks. He kicked them to death, didn't he? A great start to Mark Sneed as he returns to his boyhood club, the Salford Red Devils. And at number seven will be Lewis Dodd. Last week on the show, we said how brave perhaps it was for St. Helens to put so much on these young shoulders. We didn't need to worry. A fantastic try. We expect big things as the season carries on. And at number eight will be the King, Ronnie Ayawa of the Salford Red Devils, on his debut from the Leeds Rhinos. 106 metres and a very, very important try. He also did his work in defence as well. A great debut for the King. And at number nine, another debutant, Danny Levi of the Huddersfield Giants. Look at those runs from dummy half. He had the Toulouse Olympic on the back foot throughout the game, and I'm sure many of the Giants fans are very excited at what he's going to bring this year. And number 10, well, we should almost give him the shirt for the season. Alex Walmsley, our most picked player in last year's Team of the Weeks, and he's off again, 140 metres against a really, really good pack in the Catalan Dragons. Well done to Alex Walmsley. And number 11, somebody else who featured heavily last year, Liam Fowle of the Wigan Warriors. An assist for Liam, 126 metres made in this game, and of course, as always, always happy to put his hand up in defence. And next to him will be Rhys Martin of the Leeds Rhinos. How close did Leeds come to upsetting the apple cart? Of course, going down to 12 men early on. Four from four from Reece Martin as well. Some fantastic work throughout the game. Leeds fans will hope that will continue. And finally, Luke Yates of the Huddersfield Giants. After a couple of minutes in this game, of course, 10-0 down, maybe a couple of the Giants fans as well as the players were starting to worry, but the captain put his hand up, got that try that set them on the way to a comfortable victory. Ladies and gentlemen, it's your first Team of the Week for... So there you go, Team of the Week. First Team of the Week for 2022, Greg. Your thoughts, would you agree?
There's a few notable mentions. I think Lollahea had a good game at fullback for Salford. Cade Cust played well, could have forced his way in there.
Could have done. Absolutely. No, I mean,
David Fifita.
Fifita had a great game, mate.
Had a great game.
Yeah, meters made.
Yeah,
absolutely.
You know, I can't argue with that. Alex Walmsley, big Alex Walmsley.
Yeah.
You can't keep a tie down. Danny Houghton, top tackler with 55 this week.
That's right. Well, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely that. We'll do a bit of that in a moment. In fact, let's just jump straight to it, shall we? Let's give Greggy's moment in the sun. A phenomenal start for the season. Yes, yes. How things have changed. The Super League Raw fans, they had a great week predicting last week. A great week. Taking the top spot with 18. Well done to Dave. And, you know, he's still with us, I'm sure, Dave. Congratulations, Dave. You, of course, did the predictions last week on behalf of the fans forum. And you've got them off to a flying start. And, Greg, I have to tip my hat to you, sir. A tremendous 17 points.
Well, if it hadn't been for a couple of late tries in the first two games, I think I might have finished top this week.
Yeah, I think you mentioned that.
I'm going to take the plaudits while I can. It's a long season.
Take the plaudits, sir.
I think I should support Hull because I get off to a great start and then just fade away at the end.
Happy day. Now, well done, though. Mate. Absolutely, absolutely spot on. Well done. Outstanding. Right. We'll get away from that. Let's take a look at the first Super League table of the season. There they are, the Huddersfield Giants sitting top after that 42-14 win over Toulouse. Very early, of course, in the piece. You know, maybe if you're a, I don't know, I'm going to be a bit cheeky here. Salford Red Devils, Huddersfield Giants fans, take a picture now. I'll tell you, I'll be honest with you, I fancy Salford to be knocking on the door at the top, perhaps, this time next week. But yeah, early days. But there's your first Super League table. Right, Super League's top try maker last week. Let's take a look at that. And yes, there he is, Lollahea. 4 assists in that game for the Salford Red Devils. Cade Cust got himself 3 assists in the game against Hull KR. And then quite a few, 3 players with 2 assists. Tony Gigo, Stefan Ratchford and Brad Dwyer all with 2 assists each in round 1. We then come on to top meter maker. Of course, Tom Davies was this last year. Joe Burgess, Salford Red Devils, 184 metres. Tom Johnson, 176. And Liam Marshall.
I thought Joe Burgess was pushing our team of the week, to be honest, I must admit.
Yeah, Joe Burgess did well. But, of course, the 2 tries, quite a few players on 2 tries as well. Yeah. Josh Charnley was in there with a brace, of course. He didn't make our team of the week. I'm trying to remember who the other ones are. Whilst I'm thinking on, let me give them the mention that they absolutely deserve. So, of course, Josh Charnley with 2. So, of course, Darrell Alfertz was in there as well. And Jake Wardle also with 2 tries apiece.
Bibby with 2 as well.
Who's that, mate?
Jake Bibby with 2 as well.
Yeah, absolutely. In the team of the week, absolutely. Two tries as well. There, as well as, of course, Liam Marshall, Tommy Makerson, who we saw. Then we've put a new one in for this year because, of course, you'd expect the backs to do well, but we and Greg have always been very appreciative of the job that the forwards do. So here comes the forwards. And this is it. The hard meters are going to be solely people who work in the pack. So it's forwards only. Alex Walmsley, 140 metres game 1. You mentioned it, Greg. David Fifita, 129 metres for Wakefield against Hull. And there he is again. He was knocking around this league table all last year as well. Liam Farrell, the Wigan Warriors, with 126. So
I mean, Liam Farrell, he never drops his standard.
No.
I'm a Warrington fan, yeah? But this guy...
No, you're not.
Like, he's a machine.
He is a machine. And
I've never, ever seen him have a bad game.
No. And credit as well to Joe Westerman. because Joel Westerman as well, he also put in 126, as did Mike Cooper as well. So three of them on 126, Liam Farrell getting the graphic on this occasion. And then finally, Super League top tackle maker. We'll keep an eye on this as the season goes on. Danny Houghton, 55. Matt Whiteley with 46, or Whitley, sorry. And, of course, Cameron Smith of the Leeds Rhinos on 45 tackles.
Cameron Smith was close to being in my team of the week, I've got to admit.
Yeah, absolutely. He was certainly knocking around that. I can't disagree with that either. Outstanding. So those are the, as always, we'll keep an eye on those as we go through the season. Of course, it was at Shoreditch last year, if you remember, he was top tackler, graphic. Yet to feature on that, but you know, let's see if he can go back to back in that area. Right, round number two, here we go. Time to do the predictions. We've got the fans forum predictions. Thank you to everybody who posted a prediction before we went on air at 8 o'clock. What I did is I looked at, first of all, which team got the most votes, and then once I noticed who that team was, I then categorised it in our usual categories: 0-8, 9-17, 18 plus, and the results of the fans forum are in, and I'll be sharing those with Greg in a moment. But these are the games. Warrington Wolves welcome the Castleford Tigers to the Halliwell Jones on Thursday night. Then it's a belter between Wigan and Leeds. Of course, Leeds will be looking to get underway. And again, it's a test for Wigan. We've said that we expect big things from Wigan. Maybe we'll get a bit of an extra barometer on this one come Friday night. And then, of course, on Saturday live on Channel 4, we go to Hull FC taking on St. Helens. Luke Gale there and Lewis Dodd go head-to-head, of course. And then in the evening, we've got the Catalan Dragons taking on Wakefield Trinity, live on Sky. And on the same day, the Huddersfield Giants take on Hull KR. And then finally, bringing the curtain down on round number two, will be the Salford Red Devils when they host Toulouse. So without further ado, we'll go straight into the first one. Warrington Wolves taking on Castleford, live on Sky at 8 o'clock, Sky Sports, this Thursday. We know that Darrell Clark is out for this game. He failed his HIA. Expected that perhaps we will be seeing Toby King potentially in this game. Ollie Holmes, we don't know yet if he's going to have his ban overturned. That's not been announced as yet, but potentially Ollie Holmes as well will be missing for Warrington from this game as well. Cass will want to bounce back. What's your thoughts?
Yeah, it's an interesting one. Darrell Clark's, I think he was a bit out of sorts on Saturday. I don't know. I think Warrington are going to win. I think Warrington are going to win by... I know in the past, Castleford have done well at Halliwell Jones and put up a good show. They ended our playoff hopes a couple of years ago. They have a habit of coming and spoiling the party, but I just think Warrington. I hope we see Elliot Longstaff in the second row if Holmes is banned. I'd like to see the youngsters come through. I think Connor Wrench should be given another chance, even if Toby King is fit. Mm-hmm. I think Warrington probably. I think 18 plus.
That's a biggie. Right.
I think 18 plus Warrington.
Okay, that's a biggie. I've gone 9-17 as to half the fans forum. The fans forum 9-17 was where most of the fans forum saw this one ending. So to Warrington, yeah. So all three for Warrington. But Greg, you're going 18 plus. So you're the only one who is seeing a little bit of a difference. One right, we then shoot right across to Sky Friday night, 8 o'clock live. Wigan Warriors taking on Leeds. Leeds a spirited performance against the Warrington Wolves. Are Wigan the real deal? The fans forum think this one's going to be a close one. They've gone 0-8. Greg, where do you see it?
Well, do you know what? Leeds will be stinging. But they've got no Myler. I think Blake Austin's back.
Austin's back. Myler's going to be out. Bentley, I think he's going to be out. I'm guessing we'll be out with a HIA. I'm guessing. A bit depleted at Leeds.
I think Leeds will be stinging, and I think they'll put a good fight up. But Wigan looked a class apart the other night on Friday. Night was it? They looked a class apart, and I'm going for Wigan 18 plus.
That's a big call. That's a big call. I'm going Wigan 9-17. Like I said,
I think Wigan have got more pace all around.
I think Wigan, for me, or what I've seen of them up to now, it's one to keep an eye on. As our leads, but I think you're bang on in your analysis in the fact that, you know, we know Mile is not going to be there. We know that they're going to be without James Bentley. Fossitu is probably not going to be there as well. Yes, Blake Austin is back. And do you know what? Happy days. I'm going to, you know, Caesar, you know, the Huddersfield fans would have been throwing eggs at the telly, I'm sure, the way Caesar played against Warrington. But him and Austin, you know, it's going to be, you know, again, as a neutral in that game. I mean, personally, say I'm a neutral, you know, from a Warrington perspective, you want a Leeds win, you know, to just tighten up the table a little bit. I can't see it.
As a Warrington fan, I was mightily impressed with Wigan.
I am. I think Wigan could be very, very good this year. I've got 9-17. You've got 18+.
Yeah, you've got. As somebody said, you've got that touch of Lee Braze about the attack, and they've got the players who can execute those Lee Braze. Who's Lee Braze? Those Lee Braze kind of moves. I think we're gonna win that comfortably.
Well, I've got Dave Kells with us. I've not spoken to Dave Kell in ages. How are you, Dave? Good to see you, mate. Hope you're well and the family's well. Right, Hull FC taking on St. Helens live on the Premier Sports Channel for Rugby League, Channel 4, this Saturday.
We might get a job there if we carry on, mate.
Hull FC taking on Saints. Saints, incredibly impressive. The fans forum, they've gone big. They've gone Saints by 18+. I don't know. It's, you know, Hull without Connor.
They've got injuries. They've got players who've left. They've got Connor who's suspended. I'm fearful that this could be, that this isn't going to be the game that Channel 4 need. To keep that momentum going. Right. I'm going to go for Saints 18+. And
that's three blowouts you're predicting.
I'm hoping it's an 18+ that happens in the last 10 minutes. So it's a close game for 60, 70 minutes and then just Saints will riot. Just for Channel 4's sake, because you've done such a good job last week.
I genuinely hope the Rugby League are wrong on these ones, mate. I have to say. Right, we go on to then Saturday night, 5:00. It will be Sky Sports again. Catalan Dragons taking on Wakefield. And actually, you know, at this point, before we go into this, wait till we've got another four live fixtures on the telly.
Oh, it's brilliant.
It's fantastic, isn't it? Really, really pleasing. Long may that continue. But yeah, Catalan Dragons, obviously, they'll be battered and bruised. We know, you say they're going to, it's going to affect them, Dylan Napper. Based on his performance against Saints, he probably needs a cold shower for a couple of weeks.
That lad's a liability. He's going to be cooling his heels more than he's playing, that lad.
I agree. Obviously, as well, Julien Bousquet, I believe, is out. He's picked up a long-term knock, which is going to be bad for them as well. Yeah. And of course, Gil Dudson, it would appear, is out, albeit they've got bags of beef still to come in.
I don't know if they feed him in the south of France, mate, but I think I might move there.
happy days. Catalan shouldn't be too affected with those type of players missing. Big game. I think this is a big game for Mitchell Pearce, because personally, I was disappointed with Mitchell Pearce against
Saints. I think it probably will be, because it should be a little bit less like winter over there. And again, I'm going for 18+ Catalan.
Well, and you know what? So too are the forum. The forum's gone exactly the same, Catalans by 18+. In the spirit of friendship, I'm going to hope for a little bit less. I'm going to go 9-17 to Catalan on that one. I do see Catalan winning it, I have to say. I'm going to go 9-17 on that. Then we move on to Saturday, a 3:00 kickoff at Huddersfield. Huddersfield fans, get droves for this one. Get out for it. Hull KR travelled down from Humberside. You notice I said Humberside there, not Yorkshire, for those from that way that don't actually know the difference between Yorkshire and Humberside. But yes, it's definitely Humberside. So a Yorkshire team play a Humberside team, not a Yorkshire team playing a Yorkshire team. Have I said that enough? I think I probably have. Hull,
technically, it is each Yorkshire. It's only Mrs. Thatcher that called it Humberside. Technically,
yeah.
It's East Yorkshire, right?
Technically, but I'm going Humber. It's going to get a bit of sport going in it. Why not? So we're now at Huddersfield. Good win. This one going to be a bit more of a measure.
How do you see this one? I don't think Hull KR, as much as Wigan were a dominant force and played well, I don't think Hull KR can play as bad again.
Okay.
Hull KR were complicit, and there's a big word, complicit in their own downfall.
Complicit. Nice.
It's almost like watching the Six Nations.
Nice.
I think Hull KR are going to win 9-17.
Right. Okay. So just to give a little bit of clarity to everybody out there, the Super League Raw Fans Forum have gone Hull KR 0-8. I'm going Huddersfield 0-8. I think Huddersfield on home soil, potentially Will Price coming back, will be victorious in this one. And then finally, but certainly by no least, not least, we have Salford taking on Toulouse. 3 o'clock kickoff this one at Salford on Sunday at the 8th.
You know what? If I wasn't busy, I would go down. If I wasn't otherwise engaged, as they say in the trade,
I'd have gone down to watch this one.
I would have probably gone down to watch this for pure interest to see what's what.
Yeah.
Toulouse need to bounce back, or Toulouse are in big trouble.
I agree.
And I think come the end of play, Toulouse will be in big trouble. I'm going Salford 18 plus.
Yeah, there's a theme there going, mate. There's a theme going there.
I think this weekend will be a blowout weekend.
Right, okay. Well, actually, I'm going with you on that one. I do think, based on what we saw Salford do at Cass.
Salford have got a decent team this year, and they're going to surprise a lot of people.
Yeah, no, I don't disagree.
I don't. Toulouse have lost some players.
Yeah.
They travelled well in the Championship, but Championship and Super League are two different animals. It's all together. It's like the step up from league to international.
Absolutely.
But I think Salford are going to put 18 plus past them, unfortunately. Sorry to lose fans if any of you are watching.
Okay. And, Graham Parrish is coming. Hello, Graham. If you missed it, Graham, it's obviously, you can watch it in its entirety on Facebook. It will be uploaded tonight.
What did the Fans Forum say about
YouTube? They've gone Salford 18 plus as well. So we've all got 18 plus Salford there. Before we close the show, Greg, something we forgot to do last week. We've seen a week's worth of action now. Let's do it. Man of Steel 2022. Who are you going with this year?
I'm going Cade Cust.
You're going to go Cade Cust?
Yes.
Right. Okay. Where am I going? I'm going to go Where am I going to go? I'm going to go.
Where are you going to go? That's like Ant and Dec.
It is. Do you know what? I was thinking, do a go Aiden Caesar. I was thinking, do a go Aiden Caesar. I think Leeds are dark horses as well. See why you're going Cade Cust. Do you know what? And I think, based on the fact that last year he didn't get a sniff, and I expect him to be just as good again this year, I'm going to go Alex Walmsley.
I'm going to go Alex Walmsley.
I think, you know, he's got off to a great start again this year. He deserved to be a nomination last year.
He was Man of Steel last year by a million miles.
Country mile.
And that's why I think I almost said Alex Walmsley, and there's just something about the people who vote for the Man of Steel. As we've said all last season, they don't see the bigger picture. They just see the superstars that score the tries. They don't see the hard work that's done. They don't see the the holes that are punched to defences. They don't see the tackles being made by the big guys down the middle. They see that, I'd like to call them the glamour boys, who are on the end of the receiving ball and put the ball over the line. And that's why I don't think Alex Walmsley should win it.
Yeah.
I think Alex Walmsley should have won it last year.
He should have won it last year. And look, this far.
Man of Steel, the guy is made out of steel. Let's face
young,
it.
Young player of the year. Are you going with?
What? Young player of the year? Young player. Lewis Dodds.
Do you know what? I've got exactly the same. Exactly the same. I just think we know he's going to get... Do you know what? You know, Will Price as well. He could have a storm, couldn't he? He could have a storm of Will Price as well.
A lot of the times it's where the team finishes as well. It does.
I think Will Price will be thereabouts possibly. Right, so that brings another week to a close. We'll be back next Tuesday at 8 o'clock. All the round two action we'll be going through. We'll also be, of course, looking at all the news, making the news. And as well, of course, we'll be looking forward to week number three. To close the show, just very, very important. I'll put a graphic up in a minute. But as you can see, this year we're using graphics and this, that, the other. We would like you all to support all the Super League platforms, the Betfred Super League, Facebook page, the Betfred Super League YouTube page, obviously Sky Sports Channel 4, and all the individual clubs' websites and fans, the YouTube, Facebook and Twitter, etc. That's where we're getting our stuff from. As we say on the graphic that's about to come up, in fact, I may as well show it whilst we're doing it. We'll show this at the end of every programme. I won't do this every week for the sake of boring people. I'll just put the graphic up. But, you know, you might have seen this last week very, very briefly. I will pop it up. And I think it's important that we actually share this with people, that obviously it's about spreading the love of the game. We are not connected to any Super League club, media outlet or governing body. This, of course, may contain information from website, Facebook, Twitter, of all the clubs, and of course the things that are mentioned there. We will, of course, promote those pages. That's what we do. We don't try and pass off other people's content as our own. We're not those type of people. It's recorded in good faith for the enjoyment of all, for the benefit of Rugby League, and might neither me nor Greg receive any income whatsoever from doing this show. We do it for the love of Rugby League. We do it because we care, and that is what it's all about. So I think it's just important that we just set that up and we let everybody know that that is the case. Keep watching us, keep supporting us, get involved on the fans forum in terms of tries and what your predictions are. And as we say, every single week, we had David with us last week. If you want to come on, you are more than welcome to come on. Just drop us a line. If you want to be sitting here next week alongside me and Greg talking all things Rugby League, giving us your perspective as a fan and as follower of the game. And also maybe if you did come on the show, we'd allow you to give your predictions on behalf of the fans forum, then we'd be delighted.
It'd be great to see more people get involved. It's that last week, I've enjoyed this week. I really enjoyed last week. It's great. Not as much as last week.
And let us know what you think about the new format. Obviously, we've completely changed it this year. We're chanting our arm. You know, we put a bit more into it. We changed the look and style of it a little bit. Let us know what you think. And if you've got any ideas in terms of what you want us to do, then let us know those as well, and we'll see what we can do. But that's us for another week, Greg. So without further ado, we will bid everybody goodbye. Enjoy your Rugby League, ladies and gentlemen, and we will catch you this time next week. Keep your eye on the fans forum page. We'll keep stuff popping up there. We'll keep our eyes out for the main stories, and we'll see you next week.
See you next week, guys. Thanks very much for tuning in.